Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop. Today's episode has been sponsored in part by Lee Valley. For more information, visit their website at leevalley.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. Okay, for today's episode, what we're going to do is we're going to talk a little bit about, well, a hand plane that's been getting a lot of attention again recently by the majority of you who aren't that familiar with hand planes. But at the same time, for those of you who are addicted to hand planes like I am, like, hello, my name's Matt, and I am a planeaholic. I do spend way too much money on hand planes and spend way too much time wanting to be with them than I really should be. But I am definitely getting help from it. Now, who am I kidding? I'm feeding the addiction worse than ever. But anyways, though, what I want to talk about is the plow plane. Now, it's a very specialized plane, and as you can see, this is a modern version of it. This is Lee Valley's, their small plow plane, which makes me wonder, if it's the small plow plane, does that mean that there's going to be a medium and large one that's coming out? If it is, hello, Matt the plane addict will definitely be in line to probably have to get one of these. Anyways, though, when it comes down to it, historically, plow planes have been around probably pretty damn long when it comes down to it. And actually, my understanding of the history of the plow plane is this ended up becoming like one of those status symbols amongst all the craftsmen. In fact, you know, nowadays we think of like when somebody retires, we give them a golden watch and we send them on their way and thank you very much. And it used to be that when somebody retired from woodworking, usually a master craftsman, they would receive a very specialized plow plane, something that was definitely made from a very exotic wood, ebonies, all sorts of just amazing hand wheels in it, some knurled knobs, all sorts of stuff in it, but it would all be made of wood. In fact, actually, the wooden ones are really starting to make a resurgence. But anyways, we're getting a little bit too far ahead of ourselves. When it comes down to it, the plow plane, very, very specialized. It does one single task, but it does that one task very well. And the one task that it excels at is plowing out grooves or just grooving any type of wood. And when we're talking about grooving, we're talking about making a groove on the length of a piece of wood. So I've got my piece of wood over here. And when we're going to use this, the plow plane pretty much only works like from this end to this end. You're not going to be going across with it. In order to go across the grain, you're going to use what's referred to as a philister plane. And we'll definitely get into more about that in another episode. You can use this one, and I'll demonstrate a technique that will help you to be able to use this, not only this way, but this way. But it's a little time consuming. But you know what? If you love hand planes like I do, it's not so time consuming. It's just a time with the one you love the most. Anyways, though, so let's go ahead and let's come over to the workbench and let's get a little bit closer look at the plow plane itself, talk about a few of the components and how they work, and we'll just go from there. Okay, so when it comes down to it, let's get this up nice and close. I'm gonna kind of stay out of the frame here. Essentially, the plow plane hasn't changed that much, as I said. It's really the same creature as it ever was. It's just, of course, we have this metal-bodied version. So essentially, regardless of whether this was wood or metal, the parts were all the same. We have a sliding fence here, which of course is gonna help us, as I'll demonstrate in just a second, to actually make various grooves or make grooves depending on how far you wanna go in from the edge. I think with this one, you can go about an inch and a half, an inch and 3/8 total in, and again, it depends on the blade itself. So let's go ahead and we'll remove that. And of course, then here's the actual body itself. And as you can see, it's pretty thin. And this is really true for even like the wooden ones and any of the antique ones that you'll find. This part of the body right here, the sole, this is referred to as the skate. And as you can kind of see, as I'm turning this around, it does look very much like an ice skate when it comes down to it. And really all this is gonna do is this is just gonna kind of balance thing out, the whole body out along with the fence. So as you're going along, there's not a lot of friction here and it's not going to get in the way of the blade doing its job. Now, typically you're going to have a depth stop on it because obviously as you're grooving, you eventually want to reach a specific depth and you want to go no further. So that's what this is. And of course, this is very easy to adjust up and down. And of course, we will make our adjustments as necessary and it will take care of that. Of course, here's the locking knurled nuts for the fence itself. Typically, depending on which antique version you have, of course, there's the depth blade adjuster itself. And, you know, We're all familiar by now with Lee Valleys. This one works really, really great. A lot of people who have it, including some of the big publishers, they absolutely love this. And once I've been playing with this, I found the reason why they love it. It works so well at what it does. Now, of course, there are different size blades. This one happens to be the quarter inch blade, a very popular size. But I've got a couple other ones that I just recently picked up. And I've got the eighth inch blade, which look how tiny that is. And then the 3/8 inch blade, and they have a couple other sizes, but essentially with these, you know, you get a couple of different sizes and you are all set. And I'll demonstrate when we go to the actual demonstration itself, how using the plow plane, we can, you know, make much wider cuts. So let's go ahead and let's do that next. Let's actually groove out some material. Okay, so I've got some material put into the vise itself, and this is going to be a little awkward for me because since I'm left-handed, I tend to want to go in that direction when I'm planing. So normally I'll be standing facing that way, but of course the way the vise is set up, and I want to be able to see everything, I've got it going in this direction, and it has a lot to do with the fence itself. I can actually swap the fence on the other side. It still works just as well. I don't think the manufacturer normally recommends that, but you know what? I've done it in the past, so it's no big deal. Now, like I said, we're gonna set the depth adjuster, and we're just gonna make a light pass. I just wanna kinda groove just enough material. And the neat thing about this is once you start grooving with this, it goes relatively quick. It's so quiet compared to if we mount a dado set into our table saw or whether we use a router or not. And once you get a rhythm going, it will actually remove the material rather quickly. Of course, if you have a lot of linear feet to be doing, you know what, a powered piece of machinery might work a little bit better for you. But you know what, if you really enjoy hand planes as much as I do, you'll have a lot of fun with this. And the neat thing is, once that depth adjuster, once it hits its depth, it pretty much stops. And you'll just hear it kind of rushing along and there'll be no more material coming up. So let's go ahead and get ourselves started. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna put a little wax on the skate and the fence itself just to kind of help push things along. Okay, so I get the skate balanced onto the material and I push the fence snug against the face and here we go. And there's our first one. Oops. Now, of course, going with the grain definitely helps. Make sure you get the fence nice and balanced. Almost there. Oops. There's a hazard. Okay, so as we're doing this, for those of you listening, we are pushing along and the groove is really starting to form and we're getting these beautiful curls coming off of it. And occasionally you hear me stop and pull those curls kind of out of the way. I can already see this great groove forming with really nice shoulders, nice and square. Looks exactly like something I would see from a router if I was doing it. And I'm getting very close to the depth that I want to stop at. One thing I will mention is you have to be careful when you're first starting, because down here at the end, occasionally this tends to be a little bit shallower than the end. But once you complete the whole cut, it definitely balances itself out. And the nice thing is, unlike occasionally, yeah, it's almost there, with a router or a dado set, it's gonna be the same depth all the way across because you're pushing down at the same time. So you guarantee there's not gonna be like that occasional high spot. All right, we've hit that spot where it's not doing anything. So let me get that out of the way and I'll just finish demonstrating. Look at that, nothing's coming out. So that is completely grooved. We'll set that aside. Let's pull this out. And for those of you watching the video, you can see, I mean, that's a very nice groove. And that's all the way down and that's quarter inch. Now, of course, you want to spend a little extra time getting, make sure that it's all centered. That's up to you how you take care of the centered part, but you can see how well it works. In fact, yeah, that's pretty darn sharp. So anyways, though, that works really great. Now, one thing I can do, and what the heck, we'll demonstrate this. I'm going to actually groove this end grain here using the same one. In fact, let me get this set up in here. Same setup. Of course, I'm going to want to, typically I'll want something on the backside. You can hear that snapping. That's just some break off. Let's just go ahead and break that off completely. And what I'm doing right now is making a groove on the end grain. I'm not gonna make it to the full depth that I did the other one. But you can see how you could actually use the plow plane to make a groove all the way around. And again, we're gonna get the same effect. You can kind of see the tear out on the back side, but that's just because I didn't cut it. But again, you get a beautiful groove right down the center, and well, it looks like I went on the wrong side of the fence, but you kind of get the idea there. It works fantastic. Now, one other thing I want to do is, let's say that I've made this groove and I've decided, you know what, I need it just a pinch wider because the component that's going to fit in here is just, well, it's a pinch wider. How can I change that? Well, what you end up doing is, make sure I get the right end here, is, oops, excuse me, we can actually move that fence over just a smidgen so that we can adjust for that depth. So in this case, we're going to go ahead and, like I said, we'll just move the fence just a tiny bit so that we can widen that groove. Or, of course, you could take the one of the other blades, put it in there, say that 3/8, and you could widen it that way. But if you only have the one blade, well, this is just as easy. You just do the same exact thing. Again, get the fence in place and push it along. Now, you might have to pay a little closer attention to that fence because the blade's going to want to kind of dip over a little bit because the material's already been removed, but you can widen nonetheless. So anyway, so we'll go ahead and finish this up real quick. Again, just pushing along, and you can see the material just removing right out of there. And essentially, that's all you have to do. Works fantastic. We'll just kind of bring this up, and you can kind of see where I'm already starting to remove the material. You see that little notch right there? So anyways, though, that's what we can do. Like I said, the plow plane is very specialized in the fact that you're going to go with the long grain direction. And as you saw, you could actually tip it up with a nice sharp blade. You can go across the grain at the end of the board. But when it comes to going across the grain on the face of the board, well, that's a whole other situation. Typically, we'll use a philister. And a philister is basically a plow plane with a nice little cutter on the front of it, a knicker, and it will cut the grain as it goes. But let me show you something that I discovered I can do with this so that we can get the same effect. Okay, so I'm just gonna demonstrate this real quickly. We're not gonna get too involved with it because typically you wouldn't do this with the plow plane. But essentially what we have here is we wanna try and go across the grain. Now, like I said, typically we use a philister plane, which will have a knicker that cuts the grain ahead of it. So all I'm gonna do is I'm gonna take my little marking gauge. I love this one. This one was great. I picked it up at Woodworking in America, and it works amazing. I like to call it my back miter gauge. You might have seen this in a little expose that my good friend Mitch Robertson did for the show, and it just, oh, man, I just absolutely love this thing. It works great. Anyway, so I'm gonna go ahead and cut the grain, and I'm going to establish the small shoulder. Now, what I'll tend to do is, in this situation, I probably should have had this set up a little bit ahead of time, but I'm just going to go ahead and say, okay, well, that's about where I want it. It's right there. So we'll go ahead and lock the fence in place. And we're still going to get a little bit of tear out, but I think it's minimized enough that we can easily deal with it. So let's go ahead and get this all nice and secured. It helps if you can do both shoulders, but you know what? We'll just go ahead and mark the one, and let's go ahead and this should hold in place. If it doesn't, this is gonna be kind of embarrassing, but you'll get the idea of what we do here. So we'll, again. And the main thing, of course, is to have it nice and secured. You can see some of that horrible tear out. Hold that fence up against the edge, and I can already see this is forming not so bad, actually. We got, like I said, this little bit of tear out. A nice sharp blade would really help to minimize that, and there you go. As you can see, there is that tear out in there, but like I said, maybe we just make a couple extra knife marks here and there, and it would clean it right up. And if this is going to be a hidden component, no big deal. Okay, so the plow plane, it very specialized, does the one thing very, very well. Maybe the two, if you consider it, you know, potentially as a philister plane. But when it comes down to it, this is probably the grooviest plane out there. Groovy, get it? Yeah, my wife rolls her eyes at my jokes and pretty much walks away. But anyways, though, plow plane, so regardless of whether you get a modern version like this Veritas one, or whether you get an antique one. In fact, like I said, there's a big resurgence and there's some amazing stuff out there. A recent article in Popular Woodworking is talking about a whole family of plane makers and how their 18-year-old son, I believe it is, or he's 16. See, I don't read the articles very well, but he's making some and they're just absolutely gorgeous. And like I said, at one point they were a big status symbol. So something to think about if you've ever wondered what a plow plane does, if you've ever seen one. Well, hopefully I just explained it a little bit. But if you have any questions, of course, you know how to get a hold of me, mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Now, another great resource for all things hand plane, and I have referred to this many, many times, is the Hand Plane book by Garrett Hack. I love this book. Even if you just want to flip through it and see some, you know, just amazing pictures and colors and stuff, I mean, there's some great stories in here about hand planes and gives you an idea, a basic idea of what each one does. Very, very good book. It's out by Taunton Press. I picked up mine years ago and it's starting to get worn out. It's starting to fall apart on me. Anyway, so that is pretty much going to do it. If you have comments, questions, suggestions, you know how to get a hold of me. That's mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com. Or you can stop by the new website at mattsbasementworkshop.com, where hopefully by the beginning of February, I'll have absolutely everything worked out. You can stop by there to have all the posts, everything else. That's where you can get a hold of me, the contact sheet. If you haven't entered for the free swag, you can fill out the form there and that will come right to me. We'll get you all set. One entry is all it takes and you are in until you win or I run out of swag. And let's see, I want to mention a few other things. Of course, I haven't done this in a while. Lumberjacks, for the whole entire month of January, they have their woodworking contest going on. There are two categories. One is a knot like no other. In other words, if you have a piece that has a knot in it, which, no knot in this one, but if there was, you could use the knot, incorporate it into your piece, and explain why it looks so good and why you wanted to use it. Or there's, I'm starting to forget what the other one is. But anyway, so you can head over to lumberjacks.com and check that out. And it runs till January 31st, I do believe it is. You have to be a member to enter, but you know what? Membership's totally free and it's a lot of fun to hang out over there. So definitely check that out, lumberjacks.com. A whole bunch of other podcasters out there that you have to check their stuff out. Shannon Rogers over at Renaissance Woodworker. Of course, there's Rick over at the Splintered Board Podcast. Of course, he hasn't been putting too much up because, well, family has a new baby and everything. So I've been taking a little time off for that. Of course, there's Rick and Eric over at what's the name of it? Guys, I'm so sorry that I totally forgot the name of it. I have it in my podcast catcher, I promise. But essentially, they have their own podcast that they put together where it's a joint venture between Eric Pearson, the Novice Garage Woodworker, and Rick Peters. And of course, let's see, there is Woodworking Resource, which is Craig Stevens. Of course, there's Neil over at Furnitology. There's Dave Knopf over at the Modern Woodshop, and just all sorts of other great ones. Just definitely check all those shows out. I've got links for a bunch of them in at the website, so definitely head on over there and check it out. In fact, a lot of the stuff from Woodworking in America, where you can see more great hand plane stuff and other hand tools. Greg Stevens and Al Navaris over at Sandal Woods Productions, his podcast has also got a whole bunch of stuff up, which reminds me, I've got more stuff from Woodworking America coming up pretty soon, so we will definitely get those up. But until then, I think we are pretty much done here. Comments, questions, suggestions, once again, mattsbasementworkshop@gmail.com or stop by the website at mattsbasementworkshop.com where you can get more information. So until the next time, straight grains and sharp blades. Take care, everybody.